Hi, I'm Kathleen Ford. I'm the Artistic Director for Borasan Contemporary. And we are so thrilled to have this solo exhibition by Mika Tajima entitled Ether at Borasan Contemporary. We're also incredibly happy with the collaboration with the New Museum based in New York. For this exhibition, we have Margot Norton, a curator from the New Museum, who has curated the show. And Margot and Mika are going to tour us through the exhibition, through the ideas and the summary of the concept of the exhibition, as well as the individual artworks. But I'd love to just give a little bit of context about how this show and Mika's work in general relates to the Borasan Contemporary Art Collection, and some things we think about when we're collecting artwork here, and the kind of exhibitions that we put on. Also, Mika's work from an aesthetic point of view, if you move through the exhibition, you'll see that we're not just looking at moving image media on screens. The work in the show is all very sculptural. You're really thinking of it as installation. And that's something that we do think about with the Borasan Contemporary Art Collection. We're often looking for not only screen-based work, but who are media artists or artists working with technology in their practice who are thinking about presentations that are also object-oriented. And lastly, three works in the exhibition are commissions made specifically for the collection that will go into the collection after the close of the exhibition. They are Forced Touch, Human Synth, and Meridian. And that's a major tenet of the Borasan Contemporary Art Collection, is that it's incredibly important and profound to the mission that we're not only collecting works that exist in the world already, but that we are supporting the production of new work by artists. Having said all that, I'll leave Mika and Margot to it to bring you through the rest of the show.
Hello, I am Margot Norton, curator at New Museum, and I curated the exhibition on view at Borasan Contemporary, Mika Tajima Aether, which is on view starting in March 3rd. The exhibition explores the work of Mika Tajima, who's a Japanese-American artist based in New York. And her work is in installation, as well as video, sculpture, painting, and often incorporates like new technologies in her work as well. And all of her work explore the techniques and technologies that can shape and control the human body. Anything from architectural systems to ergonomic design to technologies that we use that influence our daily lives while we also manipulate them ourselves. The exhibition brings together four distinct bodies of work in the three main galleries of Borasan Contemporary, and each of the projects kind of speaks to these ideas of submission and control. She often works with material that's as fleeting and intangible as a human emotion, and looks at the ways that we can quantify and control these very kind of intangible substances. So all of the rooms in the galleries are looking at a distinct body of work that she created that is around these certain ideas. The title of the exhibition, Aether, is actually referring to a intangible substance, which was often referred to and thought of in like ancient and medieval practice to be this substance that is above the terrestrial sphere, but which envelops and penetrates all matter. So she is looking at the technologies that we use in our daily lives, like this substance ether, something that is invisible, but yet kind of controls the way that we experience our kind of daily activities. So I'm here with the artist, Mika Tajima, and we're standing right in front of her work, Force Touch, which is a work that encompasses a whole wall this installation. It's a piece that includes these jacuzzi jet nozzles in gold, which emit forced air. And you actually encounter the piece by hearing the sound. And then once you get closer to it, you realize that each one of the nozzles is emitting air, which is kind of touching your body in various ways. And Mika, I thought you could speak a little more specifically about this work and also like this specific installation, which kind of seems like an all over composition, but is actually very specific.
Yes, thank you. Everything I've been thinking about with this exhibition actually has to do with the sort of various infrastructure, or whether they're visible or invisible in that place technology, and the kind of pressure you feel from those sort of forces on our body. So this piece actually is sort of a metaphor for that, or is an actual physical manifestation of this invisible pressure. The air coming out that's like pressurized air that you can sense when you walk into the space. The jacuzzi jets are actually outlined they're as a diagram of the pressure points in your hands. So you can see each nozzle is in a point where a meridian acupuncture point would be. And it's an invisible map, essentially, of your body, like how the energy flows through the, and can be controlled through your hands through these different points. And so I thought that was like an apt metaphor for this sort of system of control, or something that you can't actually, that can be described in a very small point, such as your hand. And force touch, actually, the title comes from, it's a type of haptic technology that's developed that's supposed to be a touch that touches you back, in a sense. It's sort of like a reactive new type of technology. So I like this idea that rather than you touching something, something is actually a force is coming out at you.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that, thinking about these meridian points that are on our hands and how they can control all of the energies that are flowing through the body and leaving various organs. It seems something that's so abstract and intangible, yet there's supposedly these very specific points that you can touch that will release a certain energy. And I feel like it's such an apt metaphor for how we are also subject to such controls. Our daily experience, in the environments that we inhabit, such as the light in the room, and how that can kind of control the way that, we feel or we experience, the experience, any experience that we're having, whether that be in an office environment or in a museum, even the temperature in a specific space, or the ways that, work kind of pushed and pulled in various directions, just constantly. So I think that's really interesting in talking about this work and the way that air is something that's also so intangible yet can also kind of be controlled. So in the same room as Force Touch are two freestanding sculptures. This one here is a piece called Pranayama Yi, and it's a work that is also kind of modeled after an orthotic device, and includes a similar jacuzzi jet nozzle. In this work, the title I thought was interesting to mention, Pranayama, which is a Sanskrit word, but includes two separate words, prana, which I believe means breath or life force, and ayama, which is means control. This is kind of a practice that's used in yoga to kind of control the breath. I thought maybe you could elaborate a little bit on how that idea is also kind of present in these pieces, and a bit more about the construction of them as well.
Yes. This kind of piece actually encapsulates a lot of the ideas in the show, thinking about the willing relationship we enter with technology and also with control in our daily lives. It's sort of looks something in between, like a constraint device and something that would repair the body. So when I think of pranayama, it's sort of the same type of thing. It's sort of trying to control something that's energy, life, and those things are sort of all the ideas I'm sort of working with here in this exhibition, is like where there is agency and also where we willingly submit and give up some amount of control. So the jet nozzles sort of represent this idea of energy or air being forced out or through the body. And then the shape of this form, as Margot mentioned, is referencing armor, robotics, braces, and something maybe you might see like in an S&M dungeon. So there's all these sort of layers of both trying to repair or reform or control, and maybe even like there's pleasure involved in that. Always, that relationship becomes very sort of complicated.
There are these ways that these forms are like hugging the body that is also, there's something very comforting in that idea of being controlled. I think that is kind of interesting to think about how we kind of also see comfort in those things that can also control our behavior or shape us or contort us into the perfect position. We're standing in front of a piece called Social Chair, which differs from the Pranayama Eat piece in that instead of being a specific shape that's molded to form the human body, this is a piece of corporate office furniture, which is meant to hold the human body. The chair that Mika created, which is made of this walnut wood with these perforated jacuzzi jet nozzles, is modeled after a specific piece that was made for public office, which is a furniture design by Eve Behar from Herman Miller. And the chair is interesting because it's kind of meant to facilitate human interaction in the workplace, but is actually kind of at odds to that. And you know, I was curious if you could talk more specifically to that idea of like how this chair situates the body in a certain way that is kind of at odds with the philosophy of this corporate design.
Yeah, the design is something I wanted to really focus on here, this sort of paradoxical rhetoric, really, of freedom and collaboration, communing, social behavior, all that in a place that's really inhospitable to all those things. And that sort of like draws out the sort of contradiction in our daily lives, I think, with the idea of like freedom to work. The design is really referencing all the different places that work happens now, which is all in transit. It's like in a cafe, it's in a hotel lobby, it's in a train car, an airport lounge. These are all the new places where, or these are all transitory places that now we're constantly working because we don't need to go to our office now to do our labor. We are working all the time with our laptops and our phones. And so this piece kind of is oxymoronic for many reasons because it's not a place for social activity or social collaboration.
If you were to talk to this person, you would have to
face the wrong direction.
Face the wrong direction.
Yeah. And it's perforated with all these jets, which are speaking of this idea like pushing energy out and off, forward. And this is sort of like the contemporary condition of the contradiction of freedom and also a big tether, the place where all zones of life are meshed into one place, which is, I think, in transit.
There's this way that we're put in these environments for collaboration with one another, yet we're often always on our devices kind of alone, but yet communicating through those devices. And this chair is interesting because it mirrors this way that while we might be like all sitting together on the same piece of furniture, we're not really communicating with one another. Kind of like bringing you together, but yet there are these conditions that we experience that keep us apart.
Yes, isolation.
So we're standing in front of a new work that Mika created for this exhibition titled Human Synth. And it's a video installation which presents a plume of smoke, which kind of blooms and dissipates and travels across these screens, which are unable to contain it. It floats freely between the two screens. And you'll notice that the color, the speed, the direction, the intensity of the smoke are also kind of shifting throughout this installation. And all of that refers to a specific algorithm that Mika developed, which is kind of a predictive analysis, right? It takes real-time Twitter feeds in the city of Istanbul, and then using language processing as well as kind of data analysis, it takes these words and is able to kind of make a, you know, composite emotion through them. So whether it be a positive emotion or a negative emotion that's expressed collectively in the city, the algorithm will then take it and predict what the next emotion might be. And so you'll see that the smoke changes in color from red to like a deep, deep purple. All of that is based on the emotion. So I believe that it's purple that's the positive emotion and red that's the negative emotion. I was thinking, you know, if you could speak a little bit to this idea, you know, of the way that the work is taking something intangible and fleeting, and then using these algorithms to process it and spit it back at us. And you know, there's something really interesting in that, in the way that we are, you know, this is referring to kind of this collective conscious, but there's also something so futile in what it's trying to contain.
Yes, definitely. The smoke itself becomes a sort of metaphor for that which can't be captured. And thinking about the notion of the future is really shapes the present. This is why I was thinking about this idea of predicted. It's like trying to influence us to do something. It's, we think about a preemptive strike or predictive, like Google something, and it's already trying to predict what you're going to type or search for or buy. So there's this sort of notion of making that the future is already written. So this piece is really about a meditation on that sort of inability of actually knowing what is coming, so that the smoke becomes sort of more or less unformed. However, it is already being programmed. So there is a sort of like, again, another contradictory sort of paradoxical position is living, of like knowing it, if it's already been written, the future's already been written. And so that's why, if you notice the piece, the screens are actually being held by these leather straps and sort of metal hardware, which is sort of referring again to some, like the Pranayama piece, which is like ideas of constriction and like restraint, trying to sort of like contain something or hold something in tension.
But yet it's the smoke, which is like something that's kind of equally as fleeting as an emotion. Might be. And I was wondering, I mean, I spoke about it a little bit, but if you could speak a little more specifically to all that goes into this work, because I know that it's, you know, a complicated process, and you work with many different programmers to create it.
Well, thinking about this piece, I was really thinking about how our emotion and now our psyche is being mined and turned into data. So this is like through, you know, various social media platforms. But for this piece, I use Twitter because it's a text-based platform, and it's an open API, so we can use that data for all purposes, which of course means a lot of people can use that data for any purpose, which is something that we should all think about moving forward in our freedom. So we take this Twitter feed of this geographic location, and then the algorithm is processing that and using statistical analysis and language analysis, predicting what the future tweet will be, and then that is quantified. So say like many people are tweeting right now in Istanbul, oh, it's really cold, wow, it's snowing. So then it'll try to create a tweet based off of that reflects what it thinks the next tweets will be and what the feeling, the quantified sentiment of that is, which then generates the smoke. So right now you see it's kind of lavender,
right,
which means it's fairly positive.
When it's deep lavender, that means it's more positive.
Very positive. Which is also kind of a funny thing to think that like a feeling can become a purple cloud. And I like this idea that this is sort of like strange world we live in now, where we suddenly are reduced to something like a number or data, or we are transformed into something that's not us, or maybe it's some kind of reflection of us. And that's why the smoke metaphor, I think, works well, because it's constantly changing, and maybe we are not, it is not possible to represent us fully, you know.
In an algorithm or in something like smoke. We were talking before about how it also summons up some like interesting like ancient practice of reading smoke signals, which kind of goes back to ancient Mesopotamia and the using smoke signals to predict the future. Another type of technology in a way, in order to predict what might happen next. And I think
it's an interpretation.
Right, of course.
It's like,
right.
There's something in there about like what is real. If it's somebody's interpretation of the smoke signal, is it that person's influencing you to think like, oh, so this is what's happening? Like if you go to hand reader or fortune teller, it's like it's not really, it's an interpretation.
Yeah, yeah. Or like where does the truth kind of begin or end, or and where does that kind of qualifiable and quantifiable data, like where is the point where it stops? And I was thinking about the example that you used, where you said, "Oh, it's so cold outside. Some people love the cold, others don't. But does in the algorithm does the word cold conjure a negative or a positive association? And how really successful is that algorithm in what the mood of the city is if we don't necessarily have a positive or negative reaction toward a specific adjective. And right now when the smoke is white, that means it's neutral, correct? So when...
Yes.
Right.
Fairly neutral.
Fairly neutral. Just a little hint of purple or a hint of red. There's never total neutrality.
Exactly. And what is that,
Exactly. And something interesting about it too is that in using a color, but also in responding to the smoke, we as viewers are also, our emotions are also changing. We're realizing that the experience of viewing an artwork can also have an effect on our emotions, similarly to the way that this kind of push and pull of technology or forces that we supposedly control, but also have a controlling aspect as well.
Kind of feedback loop.
Right.
The energy or the ambiance of the piece sort of like kind of envelops you in a way that is like ether.
So we're standing in front of these woven paintings, which Mika created, which are called Negative Entropy. And she's described them as acoustic portraits. They're all woven on jacquard looms, and she uses a specific technology that captures the sound, a sound that she records, and then will translate them in a way into these woven paintings. And each one of them takes a very different sound, which Mika can explain in more detail. The sound can change, can be a specific voice of an individual. It could also be an action that a specific individual does on a daily basis, or can also be a sound of a specific place. And those sounds are kind of woven into these visual amalgams of that information from the sound of the individual or place. So this piece in particular is the sound of translator. And Mika, why don't you speak a bit about who she was and how this work came about?
Yes. This translator, somebody actually know, but she's a very well-known Japanese translator, but she has been important since from the post-war era to now for bringing a lot of Western writers, intelligentsia, avant-garde artists to Japan, and translates also their work, and then also sends Japanese artists, writers, thinkers to the West. So she herself has played this role of kind of mediator or, of course, translator, and kind of a human conduit for bringing culture and ideas back and forth. And for the show, I was really thinking about the role of translation and mediation, which you can see, I think, through many of the pieces. So I wanted to focus on like some people that I've worked with that I've done some portraits of, which is, of course, Kazuya, and then another one over here, which is Kim Reddick, who's the punch card maker for Chipardos at this particular factory. I wanted to think about this idea of the portrait as something that's trying to represent somebody, some aura of the person or some aspect of the person, but is like an incomplete translation or image of that person.
Something that's interesting to note, the process of the Jacquard loom, which was a loom that was developed in 1804 to mechanize the weaving process, is something that a lot of historians refer to, because the punch cards that were used to create the Jacquard loom are something that were a really crucial step in the development of modern computers. So I think it's also really interesting to note that this, you know, technology that was developed so early on is also so connected to the technologies we use today. And it's these are beautiful, and you know, but I love that in each one of them there's just such a different rhythm and feeling to the sound that you see. And this one in particular, there's so much variation to her voice. And I was curious to know, like, what exactly was she talking about at the time that you made this to create such variation?
Yes, I just let, you know, I took this recording of her that was, she's reminiscing about her time as this sort of person who's going between various places and various cultures and various countries. So this is her recalling this experience of sort of always being in between and doing these kinds of activities.
Right.
I love that in itself she's discussing this sort of like role of being in between and in transit too.
Right. All of these paintings have a color palette, which I think is really interesting, and all you know, very specific, very bright colors. Was curious to know where that color palette came from.
It comes from active wear, like sneakers and exercise clothing, and the correlation is to how those colors, that kind of color palette is chosen for also a lot of like interior design. It mirrors those sort of choices, which leads me to, you know, think about how we are supposed to be, how we live in the world, like how progressive or efficient or high performance our lifestyle should be all the time. So that's where the color palette comes from.
Right.
This idea of like high performance. And, every part of our life is sort of meshed into this place of like performing well, faster.
And if you notice, the color of this work is changing throughout the viewing of them, because the lights in the room, another work, Meridian, are also kind of changing the experience of viewing this. So this idea of color corresponding to our performance or the way that we feel at a certain time, you know, how we kind of navigate through a space and how we perform is also enhanced through the experience of viewing these in this environment. So behind us in this room is a work titled Meridian, a Symbol, piece that is actually a precursor to the Human Synth piece, Downstairs. Which is a light work that is connected to and responding to a real-time data. So it's taking the Twitter feed in the area and you know, using the language processing and you know, an algorithm developed to translate that the collective sentiment of the area into these lights. So like the piece Human Sin, the lights are corresponding to the kind of collective emotion. So they range from negative emotions, which are in a deep pink color, to a positive emotion, which is reflected right now in the lights that are a kind of turquoise blue. And I mean, at the specific moment, they're not so deep blue, so it's a positive emotion, but not quite very positive. They, unlike the human synth piece, they're not responding to the predictive algorithm. This one is dealing more specifically with real time. And Mika, for you, this was the first piece that did this kind of translation. And I'm wondering if you talk a little bit about how this work developed in the first place.
Yeah, I was thinking about how something as simple as light can really change what you perceive, and also what type of space a person is in. So if it's a different color light temperature, you feel that it's a hospital or a school or a gallery or a shopping mall. There are different kinds of light colors that set the tone and ambience for the room. So that's sort of how I started thinking about light color as a medium. And I wanted to create a piece that was like a mood light, a little bit sort of reflect the sentiment of an area. As I think about also, again, going back to what we were talking about before, now that emotion is something, human sentiment is something that's getting mined as like a product almost, like that we're willingly entering all our Twitter and Instagram and Facebook posts and things like that, that's being used. And so I'm trying to think about that being used to represent actually collective feelings. So I work with a programmer who created this algorithm that's able to sort of pool this information that we take from Twitter and then quantify it and translate that into this light color. It's now sort of, as you can see, it's like the lights respond to that sort of reduced average feeling of a city. And I love that it's like thousands and thousands of tweets of all these various individuals, all these like energy points that get sort of condensed in this room as like emitted as this soft white color.
And then kind of put back into the feedback loop of how we respond to the lights in here as well. And also included with this piece is a monitor. And perhaps we can talk about that briefly. So as part of the work Meridian Istanbul is this monitor, which is displaying the emojis which are used in Twitter feeds in the area. So similarly to the ways that our emotions collectively are also compiled, this piece is also, this monitor is kind of distilling information into just the emoticons that people express on Twitter. Mika, if you want to speak a little bit about how this is also kind of showing the information that's corresponding to the lights, and the idea about simply showing all of these like specific icons and kind of what that does to the work.
Yeah, I was originally there was the screen was in previous versions of this, it actually showed the tweets coming in. But for this show, I decided to just do the emojis as a very abstracted version of the piece. And how much can be said in something so simplified. It's two sides to the coin in a sense. It's like, on one hand, it's very reductive because it's a symbol. At the same time, there's so much in the coding that happens, and so it can be interpreted in many ways, and it's also a way to communicate that's beyond language in a sense. Like it's a different kind of way of showing emotion or sentiment or what you're trying to say. And I think about that a lot. And now that, you know, with machine learning, there's this constant like trying to understand what text and emotion and what people are feeling. And then people are trying to also confuse the algorithms, you know, by, you know, coding the way that they do things.
So in a time when, so this is a scrolling of text, but once the emojis are used, they show up on the screen. So there are times where it's black and text when it's like full of emojis,
yeah.
Depending on what somebody says. I also love how the emojis like kind of distill this like very complex human expression or human feeling into this like very simple form. It's an interesting mirror in the ways that, you know, we are kind of subject to using these analyses, these kind of quantifiable systems in order to kind of control like our own very complex and varied experience, which is